Hi, everyone. I'm Mike Vesey. Welcome to Mike's Alternate Reality Show, the talk show I put together to talk to creative people that are out there pursuing their passions. I've got a great show for you tonight. My first guest is a podcaster. She is the co-creator, co-producer, co-host of the podcast So-Called Oreos. Please welcome Nakia Swinton.
Thanks for having me.
Nakia, welcome to Staten Island, your first time.
Yeah, it's my first time. Wow. I was just driving through Bayonne and then I was right there.
Yep. Yeah. That's where we put it.
Yeah.
So, so-called Oreos. Mm-hmm. First of all, I compliment you. It's a good podcast. What I like about it is it's very well researched. Most podcasts I've listened to, it's people thinking you just turn on a microphone and talk.
Yeah.
And it'll be interesting.
Yeah.
And so many of them are, oh my God, not. Also, so many of them are just talking about pop culture, but you guys really take on some real issues.
Yeah.
I find the research is good. You guys do a good journalism job. Like, you do your research.
Thank you.
And you sound informed, which is a refreshing change.
Yeah.
How did it get started? Are you guys all friends, I'm assuming, before you started?
Yeah, so originally it was four of us. Now there's three. It's me, Janae Price, and Amari Pollard. And I met Janae through our first job at Vice Media, and then we just hit it off, and we had a lot of similarities, and we would talk about going to an all-white school and just like going to like white spaces in college, and so we just related a lot about that. And then through her, I met Amari and Rachel, who went to college. Rachel went to college with Janae, and then Amari knew her from high school. Like, they're friend, their dads are friends.
Got it.
And so we all just met, and then I was thinking about the podcast for a while just because I have a background in radio in college, and I wanted to do something close to my radio roots, and there was podcasting, but like you said, I didn't want it to be like anything or just pop culture, so I really thought about like what's different. And my cousin was always like, you know, you should talk about kind of like stuff with Oreos, like how Issa Rae did Awkward Black Girl, and I loved Awkward Black Girl. That was kind of like the reason why I started it, because that was the only thing I saw that was really resonated with growing up in an all-white school. And so I just told Janae, like, I was thinking about for like a year. And then she was just like, yeah, I have a friend that, like, you know, would relate to it too. And then that's kind of just how we started, and here we are. Yeah.
Well, I think we should define Oreos for us ignorant people.
No, it's okay. It's not, it's like I feel like it's a term like half people know, half don't, but Oreo is basically a term where you're considered black on the outside, white on the inside, like the Oreo cookie. So it's basically like people would say like, you talk so white, or like, you're acting white, or stuff like that, or their common phrases of like, oh, you're an Oreo. So we wanted to kind of like reframe that and embrace the term Oreo, and talk about the topics like that are just not pop culture, like you said, but kind of like really going underneath the surface of like all these topics. So yeah.
Yeah, no, as an old white guy, I listen to your podcast, I'm like, oh, that, I never thought of that. It never occurred to me, you know, but that they're all, and I guess, yes, I mean, Oreo sounds like it's supposed to be, I guess not derogatory, but it's supposed to be like a...
Yeah, I think it's supposed to be like kind of like a joking insult, like,
yeah.
Oh, you're an Oreo, or yeah, something like that. But
if that's your experience, that's your experience, you know, it's like...
Yeah, and I don't think I realized how common it was until we started the podcast, because... Like I said, I knew Awkward Black Girl. I knew a lot of people resonate with that. And Issa Rae, that was like her first project before she came all this way to like Insecure.
Is that what brought her to the attention of HBO?
Yeah, Awkward Black Girl. It's funny because in her interview, she'll be like, oh, I don't understand why all these high schoolers looked at that. But I don't know why she does. I would love to talk to her about that, because that's what me and my friends looked at when we were like 15, 16, mm-hmm. That's what we saw on the internet, and then that's kind of, like, how she came to HBO, like, I mean, it was a long journey, but that was, like, one of her first big projects, so I just knew, like, from the podcast, everyone would come up to us, and we get messages online, and people are like, wow, I never knew that other people, like, felt like this, like, I feel seen, I feel heard, and so those are, like, very encouraging, like, messages to keep, like, going and pushing the podcast to be, like, larger and larger.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it sounds like it's growing. It sounds like you're really reaching people.
Yeah, we've got some luck in, like, the last couple of months with especially Instagram, which has really been the base of, like, reaching people, because a lot of people with podcasts, like, you know, a lot of older people don't, like, know how to access the podcast app. A lot of people are just, like, not into podcasts, especially with COVID. No one's really commuting, so it's hard to kind of get that new audience. But now we're really leaning into socials kind of just to be the base of, like, bringing in people to the podcast, usually.
Sounds like a sound plan.
Yeah. I figured, because it's, like, our audience is mostly millennial, so... I feel like most people are on Instagram out of all the platforms, so we do try to put a lot of effort into it. I'm not, like, a huge fan of Instagram, so it's very helpful that I have my co-host to help me. But I mostly focus on the audio production side of the podcast.
Yeah, which is solid. I mean, it's another thing about podcasts I don't like. A lot of people think you can just talk to a microphone and it'll sound good. You know, I listened to a podcast last year. There were three guys. One was on a microphone. One was on a microphone. And one was all the way over here. But this was, they were in the same room. They were sitting at the same table. I'm like, how did that happen?
Yeah. I think a lot of that comes from, like, I went to school for media. So a lot of that was, I took audio production class. And, like, my number one thing was, and I did radio. So I'm always, like.
Oh, so you did radio.
Yeah, I did radio for 4 years. So I know a lot about audio production. So I, like, before the podcast even started, I'm like, this has to be solid audio. I don't want anyone turning it off and saying this is bad audio. So I'm still, like, bettering my production skills in Adobe Audition because it's harder now that we're doing it all in Zoom. So sometimes Zoom is, like, wishy-washy, but I'm trying to get it as crisp as possible. And hopefully after Zoom, we can do it in person, and that might sound a little better.
Okay. So. And I think Zoom is just going to continue to get better on its own.
Yeah, I hope so. Yeah, it's the only thing we really have right now.
Yeah. So what made you get into radio? I mean, obviously you've been into radio since you were a freshman in college.
Yeah, obviously I was 17,
That was a target before you got there.
Yeah, so radio I kind of just almost fell into. Like, when I went to school, I didn't really know what I wanted to do. I was 16, 17, and my dad was just like, oh, you know, I think you'd be really good at, like, broadcast or media. And I was like, that sounds fun. That was literally just how I got to school. And then, like, the first week, we had a career fair, and the radio station was the first table I saw, really, and I just went up to them, and they were like, yeah, you can have your own show. And I was like, wow, that's awesome. So I just did the test the first semester, got the show, like, right before my 18th birthday, and I did it all throughout college, and it was very monumental because I met a lot of friends and people that are very important to me until this day. And then it also was the reason why I got a lot of my internships, because a lot of people saw that I did radio and I put a lot of work into that, and that's kind of honestly what started my career in general.
Yeah, media. That's pretty cool.
Thank you.
Was your radio program also mainly a talk thing, or did you?
It was a mix. So the radio station, it was underground, so we couldn't play anything that was top 40. And if we did, it had to be top 40, like, 7 years ago. And so my station was the only one that was really, like, hip-hop. So I would interview a lot of local hip-hop artists in Jersey and, like, the New York tri-state area. So it was known where, you know, people would tell their friends, and I would get a lot of rappers coming to me, like, oh, I want to talk about this on your show. So I met a lot of rappers and, like, music artists, because I also did music press in college, like an internship in music press, so I had more of an interest in music. So it was a lot of hip-hop interviewing, and then I would talk about things that I just wanted to talk about. So it was mostly, like, politics and then, like, some pop culture, because that was appealing to college students. So.
Yeah. Look, I love pop culture. I mean, you want to talk about Star Trek, I'll talk about Star Trek all day. I'm not putting it down. I'm just saying.
No, I get it. Like you said, there's a lot of podcasts that are pop culture, and I just knew that also podcasts are saturated, and I knew we weren't going to that wasn't going to set us apart talking about pop culture. So, and it was also not something we were passionate about. So it just wasn't a fit. Kudos to anyone who does pop culture and makes it work. I don't think I can, but yeah.
No, you guys definitely have passion for what you talk about.
Yeah.
No question.
Yeah.
Were there any broadcasters, journalists, TV people that you admired growing up?
That's a good question. I think I didn't really start paying attention to things until high school, probably.
Okay.
So I would say it was probably, like, Issa Rae, Shonda Rhimes, Ava DuVernay, which probably sounds like a lot of girls are like, yeah, that's mine too.
Those are pretty good role models.
Exactly. So I was reading, like, Shonda Rhimes' book, and when I got to school, that was more prevalent when I was more into media. And I remember them being on the cover of Essence. This was before Insecure came out, and I, like, ran to my mom. I was like, oh my god, Issa Rae's on Insecure, like, on the cover of Essence. And, like, she did not know who I was talking about, but I was just like, I swear she's gonna be big. I'm sure my mom doesn't remember that conversation, but I wish I recorded it, because I'm like, I know she's going to be big. She's going to be amazing. And then look where she is today. So that's pretty inspiring. So I think all three of us really love Issa Rae and just, like, the Awkward Black Girl web series. And the other two girls are also journalists, so they pay attention to media and journalism. And that's probably why the show sounds like three journalists are talking, or well-researched too, because, like you said, I didn't want the podcast to be just like, another person was like, I have a podcast, but, like, we put a lot of work into it, so I'm hoping we can receive some monetization after a while.
Yeah, definitely. So, Who's your dream guest at this point?
Dream guest. Okay, it's probably Issa Rae, but also Rihanna and Barack Obama.
All right.
I don't know about the other two girls. I mean, Janae would probably say a K-pop guy, and Amari would probably say...
A K-pop guy?
Yeah, like a K-pop singer. She's really into K-pop. It's probably Jimin. Okay. She's going to hate me that I said this. Okay. It's K-pop. She's a BTS fan. And Amari would probably maybe say Paramore, like Hayley Williams. I feel like I'm on like that show that's like, how well do you know your podcast guests? So I think that's what we would have. Yeah.
Well, I'm definitely going to keep tuning in. I understand you're on YouTube now. Like, we can actually see you guys.
Yeah, you can see us on YouTube, So-Called Oreos. You can find us on any platform, So-Called Oreos. The YouTube is mostly our videos, like our podcast, just you can see us talking. Mm-hmm. And then our Instagram, we also do a lot of like cute, funny videos. So a lot of people enjoy those too. Amari does a lot of the skits. She's pretty good at that. So we've kind of just gave her that platform, and a lot of people resonate with it. So if you like video, go to the Instagram.
Well, thank you, Nakia. Again, the So-Called Oreos, you can Google where to find it. The audio podcast is on several platforms, and the video podcast is on YouTube, and I totally recommend it. We'll be right back after this.
Ugh, I can't decide.
Just pick something, anything.
We're going to end up watching what you want anyway.
You're joking.
Nope.
We always watch what you want to watch.
Are you serious?
I'm serious.
You really want to have this conversation?
Yeah.
Good evening from the Health Education Campus of Case Western Reserve University and the Cleveland Clinic. The commission has designed the format, 6 roughly 15-minute segments. Both have agreed to these rules.
So we're here.
We literally never watch anything that I want. We always watch what you want. As soon as the movie starts, you get up anyway. As soon as we sit play, she gets up. She's like, oh, I gotta go get water. I need to get water. Why do you gotta do all these things right when I turn on?
I just need to go to the bathroom.
You don't even tell me to pause. You just get up. You just get up and walk away. Why does she need ice cream right now? Why does she need ice cream? It's 3 in the afternoon. What is she doing? You don't even watch movies. Because you fall asleep. You fall asleep every time we watch
Stop
movies anyway.
Lies,
Sleepy Claire over here.
Halfway through the movie, he'll be like, oh yeah, I've seen this.
I've seen a lot of movies. I'm a great movie watcher.
So
yeah, when we go to bed, the only thing that she wants...
puppy videos and dogs.
Yeah, it's adorable.
Dogs left
Who doesn't
right.
like dogs? She
it's
wants
nice
to watch Forensic Files when she goes to bed. That's the only thing that puts her to sleep. Murder. 3 hours of top 20 lists of Watch Mojo that she wants to watch. Oh, the top 10 scariest moments in movies from the 1970s during the Russian oligarchy. Who gives a shit? I paid for memberships.
Disney, HBO.
I paid for lots of memberships.
Would you please shut up?
What?
Let me
Do you
talk.
See this? Rude.
So
it's a rude person.
We end up watching superheroes.
Superheroes are great. What's wrong
so
with superheroes? They're American. What movie is as good as Avengers Endgame? What movie is as good as Avengers Endgame that you want to watch? What movie is as good as Avengers Endgame? I watch
they
Hulu.
They don't have
I have Hulu. I have all the apps. I have Hulu. I have Netflix. I have Amazon movies. Prime. I have Cinemax occasionally when there's a trial. Let's talk about Harry Potter. Let's talk about how there's 8 of those movies that I've seen a bunch that you watched. Why aren't we going to talk about Harry Potter? What's up with Harry Potter, Claire? I'm
whatever
convincing you.
He wants.
We only watch what you want to watch. How do we know you don't want to watch all the Marvel movies? I don't have to watch Marvel movies all the time. She never has to watch Marvel movies.
So you're
movies.
Saying what? Right here, right now.
I don't. What?
That we're not watching any more Marvel movies.
I don't know.
We're not watching any more.
Pick a movie. I'll pick any movie. We'll never watch it again. I don't know.
Avengers Endgame.
I will stand by on Avengers Endgame. I don't know. What are we even here
that
for?
That doesn't even
She's
make any
liar.
Sense. And that is the reason why. Are you sick?
Shut up. You're sick. Listen.
Now, here he is, the writer and co-star of that very funny video, comedian Jason Pirro. Jason Pirro, how are you?
I am good. How are you doing, Mike?
I'm doing well. Doing well.
Good.
Yeah, the show, you know, I've been doing a lot of Zoom on the show. I took the summer off. I did 3 shows in June. And those are all Zoom. Those were fully Zoom. But this show, I'm back in the studio for one interview and back on Zoom for this interview. So
using
all the tools at my disposal.
Might as well. Got to do it.
Yeah. But I really enjoyed your comedy sketch.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Definitely related to it. My wife never chooses what to watch. Never. And the only
that's
thing
good of you to admit that. That's pretty good for you to admit.
I beg her. I hand her the remote. I hand her all the remotes. I'm like, pick something. I hand her my phone with all the apps on it. Pick something. But totally. The only thing she ever chooses is when I'm not in the room, she'll put on the Law and Order Marathon, which is somewhere all the time. Like they say it's 5 o'clock somewhere. Well, Law and Order's on somewhere.
Can't go wrong with that, to be honest. Everybody loves Law and Order, a little mystery, a little law and order. I mean, honestly, but yeah, it's always a good show. It's a good staple, been around for a long time, and you know, anybody could see why. So yeah, definitely a good choice.
Yeah, it drives me crazy. There's so many shows she has not seen. I'm like, can you watch The Americans so we can watch season 3 together? You know.
Is that your big show, like, currently that you're trying to watch with her? Or are you trying to get her into anything new that came out recently, maybe?
Yeah, I got through seasons 1 and 2 of The Americans last year.
Okay.
And I've been begging her to catch up so we can get back to it. So,
cool. I heard it was good, but I have yet to see it. There's so many shows on. It's impossible to just stick with one show. There's just way too much. I don't know how anybody does it.
Especially me. I fall asleep after watching an hour of TV every night. So I've been 6 hours. You know,
it's tough,
but I definitely enjoyed your piece. I mean, now you've been doing sketches for a while. I mean, I've known you about 5 years, and you were doing sketches way back then.
Yeah, I was. I've been sketch writing in New York City for almost 5 years, I think now. I hadn't been doing a lot of video sketches, but obviously, when everybody had to go inside, and you know, we didn't have that many options, I was doing a lot of stand up and whatnot. But now having to be stuck inside, mostly my resources are limited, but I kind of tried to just take advantage of it in a weird way and use the time to kind of get better at video making and filmmaking and editing and that kind of thing. So I had an idea for just making sort of like a mini sketch series with my wife, just a couple of sketches, mm-hmm. short things, just to kind of get a little better at making that kind of thing, just all about being stuck inside and how we're dealing with it. And that kind of went really well, and she enjoyed doing it, and we didn't kill each other while making them, and we just decided to just keep going and see, you know, how it goes. And so that 6 sketches, which I didn't even know if I was going to be able to do, turned into over 20 now that we have. We're trying to put one out every week, every Monday if possible, and putting them on YouTube and Instagram, and it's been a lot of fun.
How many are out there so far?
I think, I want to say just over 20. I think we might have just still, we might have literally just did our 20th maybe.
That'll be my next binge. That'll be my next binge.
Okay, great. Yeah, they're all pretty quick. You could fly through them in one episode of Law and Order, I would say. So be good to go.
Very cool. Was your wife an actress before she got locked up with you?
No, she wasn't. She works in international affairs. So she's, I think she's been on camera inadvertently while dealing with like political figures and the like, but she's never actually done like theater or acting work or anything like that. So, I didn't want to like force her into anything if she was like uncomfortable doing it or anything. It was just kind of like a funny idea at first.
Yeah.
And she was totally on board and she really enjoys it. She's, you know, a little self-conscious as I am, as we all are with being on camera, but she's gotten really comfortable with it and gotten really into it. And she has a whole fan base through her friends and family that watches sketches and really like watching them and seeing, you know, what she's going to be in the next Monday.
Nice. Well, she's delightful in the sketch I saw. So
thank you. I appreciate that. I will let her know.
Yeah. So do you miss stand-up?
I do to a degree. I mean, stand-up for me, it was always a little anxiety-inducing, so it's very high risk, high reward, or at least that's the way I felt. Always feel uncomfortable going to do it. And I think just, you know, not being able to do it, I'm kind of missing it. I'm kind of missing being able to network and see those people and kind of practice stand-up and try new jokes out. But on the other hand, this has kind of given me some sort of reason to justify being lazy about not going. Like, it's no longer my fault if I don't go. It's like, I can't, you know, there's things going on in the world. So it's a little bit of column A, a little bit of column B, but like, again, with the sketches, and I've been doing a lot of writing. So I've been trying to, I think I'd be going a little more crazy if stand-up was my only thing. But I've always been more involved in writing. Actually, I went to school for film and screenwriting. So that's been, you know, filling that void of creative stuff.
Cool.
Yeah.
So sticking on stand-up for a moment, what got you started in it? Like, I got started, it's something I always wanted to do, and I got started with a comedy contest. So that got the first 5 minutes written.
Okay.
I grew up listening to Bill Cosby, Woody Allen, and Bob Newhart. So I'm just keeping my fingers crossed that Bob Newhart can keep it together.
Let's hope.
Yeah.
Let's hope. 2020, we still got a couple months. So we'll see, you know, never know. I was always a big fan of stand-up. I watched all the time with my dad growing up. We would watch anything and everything. George Carlin was a big comic in my house. I watched a lot of him. But honestly, I kind of just fell into it. I had started with the sketch writing and the comedy writing, taking classes at UCB and meeting people through that. And when I moved to Astoria, where I live now in Queens, I just happened to walk by this place that I didn't even know was there, a comedy club by me called QED, and they happened to have a poster in the window for a comedy class that would then end with a comedy show, sort of like a mini recital for your friends and family and stuff. And so stand up, doing an open mic, just going up there once was always kind of a bucket list thing for me to see if I could just do it once without, you know, throwing up or passing out kind of thing. And the class, I think, was a good way for me to get a little more comfortable and then kind of forced me to do that open mic finally. And so I took the class and I had the show at the end of the class and I was super nervous. And like 5 minutes before the show was supposed to start, there was nobody there. And I was like, is nobody going to be here? And, you know, it's going to be even weirder and going to be a mess. And like right before the show started, the teacher showed up, the other comics showed up, the whole room got packed, which made it anxiety inducing for different reasons. And I was totally terrified, but I got up there and I think I did pretty well. And I had a lot of people come up to me that I didn't even know telling me that I did well. And then, you know, you have the friends and family telling you like, oh, you did a good job. And, you know, they're going to say that either way and kind of patronize you, think, but like, I had a few of them like, no, like we thought you were going to be terrible. Like you were good. Like really, like you were actually good. So that was a little encouraging. And I think it was just more of something at that point, kind of like, you know, me trying to be more out of my comfort zone and face my fear and just see it as something that I was interested in and wanted to get better at. So I just kept doing it. And, you know, a year later, I'd, you know, been on stage 100 times and had done some festivals in New York City. And I performed in Austin and Chicago. And yeah, so I've been really enjoying it. Like I said, it definitely still freaks me out to go up on stage and do that. But as freaky as it is, it's that much more of a reward when you actually are telling those jokes and you actually, you know, kill on stage or you do really well. It's great. It's like skydiving. It's like a drug. You know, it's hard to get away from that and not want to get that more and get better at that.
Yeah, it's the biggest thrill when you succeed and the biggest pain when you fail.
It can be tough when you fail, for sure. I think I got better at that as soon as I started also, just because I think it's more the fear of failing more than the actual failing. I think a big part of stand-up is just like the art of failing well. Like I think you get a lot of anxiety, just worried about what's going to happen and how people are going to feel and, you know, how you're going to feel when you bomb or, you know, how embarrassed you might be. And I remember thinking the first time after I bombed really badly, I actually kind of felt good in a weird way because it was cathartic because I just looked around and, you know, nobody beats me up. I didn't lose anything. You know, it just didn't matter. It was therapeutic, and it just made it easier for me going forward to realize, like, you know, if you bomb on stage, like it doesn't matter. People bomb all the time. In fact, that's part of it. You're basically bombing on, not on purpose, but you're bombing to get better and learn what not to do and how to be better even in failure, so that you can kind of pick yourself back up and keep going.
Yeah. What I kept telling myself, if you bomb, you're a bad comedian, but you're still a comedian. And if, you
absolutely
know, I want to be a comedian, yeah. Right? You know, so
definitely. I've seen everybody, every comic I know, famous comics, all the ones I've seen them bomb. I've seen clips of them bombing, and all the comics I know personally in New York, the ones that are great, the ones that have been on television, I've seen them bomb in small bars where nobody knew them or cared about them, and right. They got heckled. So I think it's just par for the course. It's something you deal with, and it's kind of how you, you know, earn your marks.
Yeah. Yeah.
Definitely.
Do you ever get into improv at all?
I tried improv after I did sketch writing. I took two improv classes at UCB. The first one was a lot of fun. Because nobody knows what they're doing and everybody's terrified. And I think it's a really good bonding experience. It's kind of one of those things. It's a cliche for everybody to say like, oh, you should take an improv class, you know, at one point in your life. But you should take an improv class, I think, at one point in your life. I think it's a less it's a lower risk version of stand-up where I feel like you're really kind of putting yourself out there, but it's kind of a team-based sport and you're supported and the whole thing is about just learning to be comfortable with whatever anybody does and with whatever you do and kind of breaking out of your shell. So I liked it at first. I think, I don't know how far I would want to take it or would take it. I mean, you know, fast forward after that, I definitely took like a level two class at UCB and that was a little more intense and people were a little more in their head about it and trying to learn techniques. And I think it just got a little too serious. And I even did a paid show one time where somebody paid me to do improv and it was just like a really, like doing bad stand-up is one thing, but it's all you. Doing bad improv is like life altering. Like, it's just terrible. Like, it's traumatizing to just do, like, I could do jokes in front of three people in a bar. I cannot do improv in front of three people in a bar. That's just depressing. So, yeah, I don't see me, if, you know, if something comes up, maybe I would maybe do it a little more, but in general, I don't think it's for me. I think it's probably the last on my list.
Yeah, it's funny because I do improv, but I do stand up and I also do acting, and I definitely prefer the scripted environment. You know, I like having a solid script that I can work with on some level.
I think that's a personality thing too. I'm used to that, and just especially coming from like a writing background, I like having that control and kind of being able to kind of tweak it as I see fit and practice on it. There's some really great things that could come out of improv. You know, that's the whole point, but it's very, you know, hit or miss. And just as much as you could have like a one-time night where it's fantastic and nobody ever sees it again, you could also have a lot of times where it's just like what the hell is going on? And, you know, it just gets really weird. So I don't know, I guess like anything, you kind of, if you practice it more and get more into it, you get more comfortable with it. But I think I never got to that level with it. So I'm just still kind of a little uncomfortable with it. I'm more comfortable with just doing and writing my own thing and going from there.
Yeah. So what do you got planned next? More sketches with the wife, of course. But when the world opens up, what do you hope to do first?
Well, aside from the sketches, yeah, we're trying to keep that going, but I've been doing a lot of writing. Otherwise, I'm looking for, actually paid writing jobs. That would be the ideal situation. So I've been working on a lot of packets and things of that nature, trying to network more and trying to see if there's, anybody out there that will, give me money for any of these things. So I think that's how the thing with the wife actually started, is it was just a way to kind of expand that visibility and give me something to, you know, a body of work that I could show people, the show that I can write and I can produce while inside and not able to really get out there and meet people in person. So I probably will just kind of expand that and do more of it on a more of like a on steroids kind of level, where I'm actually out and about talking to people and doing things on stage again. I was on a house sketch team before this all happened. So I might go back to that and maybe write and produce sketches for the stage. Hopefully go back to stand up. I feel like that's a great, you know, thing for me to just keep, you know, in touch with people and just work on my writing and stay humble. Yeah, so it'll be kind of like a mix of all those things. But I guess, you know, we'll see when that happens.
Yeah. Well, it's terrific, Jason. Keep up the good work. It's great seeing you. Great catching up with you.
Likewise. Thank you. And great seeing you, too. I'm glad you're doing this again. And thank you. Thank you for the lovely background. I'm a big fan. Very sharp looking.
Yeah. But we will talk soon.
Sounds good, man. Take care.
All right. I want to thank Jason Pirro for appearing on the show via Zoom. Jason's a very funny guy. When the world does open up again, I totally recommend going to find him in a comedy club. I want to thank him. I want to thank my first guest, Nakia Swinton of So-Called Oreos. Check out her podcast. And I want to thank you for watching. I will see you next time. Good night.